Kentucky, 1907. Deep in the heart of tobacco country, the night riders strike. Their ultimate target, the tobacco baron who's seizing control of their industry and their livelihoods. His ruthless price fixing has driven this secret band of tobacco farmers to take the law into their own hands. They bring death and destruction in their wake. It looks like war, but is really only the first battle fought this century against the growing power of those who control tobacco's newest product, the mass-produced cigarette.
The way the tobacco industry has behaved over the last 50 years is the worst example of corporate irresponsibility that we've ever seen in the history of the world.
I think it's probably the most irresponsible fraud ever committed on the public in this country's history.
I hate them with a perfect hate.
The real terrorists in my book are the tobacco companies. If anybody deserved the label of Murder Incorporated, it would be them.
By the year 2025, 500 million people will die of smoking. Now, that's a Vietnam War every day for 27 years. That's the Titanic sinking every 27 minutes for 27 years.
The cigarette is the 20th century's most familiar and perhaps most successful consumer product. It's also one of the century's biggest killers. It's made huge fortunes. It's built vast corporations that are fighting to protect this tiny tube of tobacco and the wealth that it represents.
These are adults. They've made a choice. And they want to smoke, increasingly, actually. You know, you see people, they just want to smoke.
There are more smokers in the U.S. today than voted for President Clinton in either of the last two elections. So, I mean, this is hardly a minority activity.
There's no question what the objective of the other side of this debate is trying to do. Their objective is to put us out of business.
We're selling more cigarettes today than we've ever sold in the history of this world. Ever. And we will sell more tomorrow than we sold today. That's enough, you know.
The tobacco harvest in Kentucky, nicotine found mainly in the plant's leaves, provides the key ingredient of a cigarette. And it's the way the human body absorbs nicotine from this plant, which makes the cigarette unique, different from all other tobacco products developed since Walter Raleigh brought the news of this vile and loathsome weed back to England.
The phenomenal success of the cigarette is based on how easy it is to inhale nicotine from a cigarette compared to from a cigar or a pipe or the way it was used in the last century. The cigarette as a drug delivery device is unique. People smoke for nicotine. So you can look upon each cigarette as being an injection of nicotine. You can get an immediate feeling of well-being by injecting yourself through the lungs with this drug. It happens in 3 to 8 seconds. So fast compared with other drugs that you take that you feel that it's instantaneous. You just light that up, you take that inhalation. As soon as that hits your lungs, there it is, you have it.
The cigarette is a 20th century phenomenon. This quicker, easier, less messy smoke had all the convenience consumers wanted. It became the fast food of tobacco products. Yet tobacco is only part of what's inside the modern cigarette.
The modern cigarette is extremely complex. A cigarette contains everything from sugar to wine, licorice, chocolate, all kinds of herbs, spices. There's 8,000 or more chemicals that come out when you ignite that and suck on it. And having them delivered in the right ratios and the right ways is a substantial engineering feat.
It's a feat that created a $200 billion business that ranks alongside the oil and car industries. This is Tobaccoville in North Carolina, a vast industrial complex producing cigarettes by the billion. It's the biggest and most automated tobacco factory in the Western world. A century ago, this was a rural backwater until the cigarette became the smoke of choice across all sections of society. That tiny tube of tobacco built boom towns across the southern United States. But the wealth that helped create towns like Durham was born of controversy, as witnessed by the century's first tobacco war.
It was perilous times. The Night Riders were able to instill within people a great fear.
The Night Riders were themselves tobacco farmers, rebelling against the ruthless price fixing of those controlling their industry. They torched tobacco warehouses and storage barns, and they sometimes killed those who opposed them, as victims' relatives recall.
The Night Riders whipped him with thorn brush. It was a brutal beating, and his back must have looked something like a chopped beefsteak. He died from the bruising of his kidneys during the beating.
Many more fell victim to similar treatment. It was the most sustained and violent uprising in America between the Civil War and the race riots of the 1960s. The Night Riders' ultimate target was this man, James Buck Duke, who founded the modern cigarette industry. He was the first to see the potential of applying mass production methods to the cigarette. This Bonsack machine was able to produce 200 pre-rolled cigarettes a minute. As the mass-produced cigarette took off, Buck Duke was the first to successfully exploit the cigarette package's marketing potential. Crucially, he and the industry ensured that tobacco avoided being regulated as a food or a drug. Tobacco was to remain beyond serious government control for the rest of the century.
The cigarette industry has been granted by the governments around the world a very special place where they don't have to test their products. It's different than every other industry that I've ever been aware of. I mean, can you imagine even buying something as simple as a bar of soap without having some feeling that it had been tested for safety and wasn't going to take your skin off? I mean, you know, every product that's sold that comes in contact with the human body usually is tested for safety and for efficacy, but not a cigarette.
Little or no regulation, yet the prime ingredient, nicotine, is a compound that's lethally toxic in anything other than very small doses. The yellow and red spots show nicotine in the brain. There it stimulates the pleasure pathways releasing dopamines, a chemical that's also released by sex. The nicotine stimulates other areas of the brain which heighten awareness.
When you inhale a cigarette, the nicotine goes to various sensors in the brain. It's what we call a central nervous system depressant, so it kind of relaxes you, but at the same time it stimulates you. So it's a very unique drug that both stimulates and depresses at the same time.
The First World War caused a revolution in smoking habits, introducing a generation of men to the new convenient smoke. British soldiers received a weekly ration of 50 cigarettes, known as fags. They quickly became essential to sustaining morale.
It was a great comfort to everyone to have cigarettes. In the circumstances in which we were living in those days, in the mud, in holes in the ground, in trenches, sometimes in expectation of anything that could happen, the cigarette was something they looked forward to, and everyone would want a fag. Before they went over the top, for instance, they would have that drag, and then they would throw the cigarette away because they would have something else to do. It, shall I say, did something to their nerves that needed to be done. And I've seen people absolutely confused before they had a cigarette, and then as soon as they had the first drag, as they called it, they settled down, and I could see the relief on their faces.
Demand for cigarettes now outstripped supply. In answer to a query from the home front, General John Pershing, commander of the American Expeditionary Forces, stated, "You ask me what we need to win this war? I answer tobacco as much as bullets." Back home in the United States, the cigarette habit took longer to take hold. Soldiers returned to a land of prohibition. Towns like this one made smoking an arrestable offense on moral rather than medical grounds. From then until now, the act of smoking a cigarette has been linked with unacceptable behavior. In the early 1920s, it wasn't considered very feminine, and certainly not ladylike, for a woman to smoke.
Puff your cares away. Puff, 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 night and day.
If a woman smoked a cigarette, she was looked upon as very, very unusual. But some did it, shall I say, out of bravado. And that was mostly what they did in those days. It wasn't very common. Very seldom did you find a woman smoker, and it was looked down upon.
For a woman to smoke in public was particularly frowned upon.
I made sure that no one ever saw me smoke, like Queen Mary. I was very, very careful about that. I only smoked in private.
In the street, it was unladylike, and possibly on the tops of buses.
The cigarette industry was determined that more women should take up the cigarette habit. In 1929, a New York public relations executive was asked to help.
One day, Mr. George Hill, president of the American Tobacco Company, called me in and said, "We're losing half of our market." And I said, "Why, Mr. Hill?" He said, "There's a taboo by men that does not permit women to smoke in public. What can we do about breaking down that taboo?"
Some women in the 20s had adopted cigarettes as a badge of their newly won emancipation. The industry decided to capitalize on this. They called women's cigarettes torches of freedom and arranged a publicity stunt.
So I called up a debutante friend of mine, asked her to get another friend and to walk in the Easter parade, lighting torches of freedom to protest man's inhumanity to women by a taboo against smoking.
The papers ran the story. The cigarette industry now began seriously to target women smokers. They pushed nicotine's ability to suppress the appetite. American Tobacco's Lucky Strike brand led the way.
Light up a Lucky Strike
right now.
Light up a Lucky.
It's light up.
Reach for Lucky instead of a sweet was thought up to get women to smoke, and then by sort of making the argument that sweets would probably make you fat, whereas cigarettes wouldn't.
I remember this extraordinary picture of the lady who was smoking cigarettes because if she smoked cigarettes she didn't eat, and so she kept slim.
I can go for hours without eating because I smoke. It is a substitute for eating.
I think it worked well for a period there in the way back in the 20s where women did switch from sugar products to cigarettes.
In the 1930s, most people attended movies regularly. Theaters became crucial places for the industry to advertise its wares.
Hello there, remember me? Same Johnny you hear on the radio, inviting you to smoke Philip Morris, America's finest cigarette. Right now, it's my pleasure to bring you some slow movies. I know you'll enjoy it.
The tobacco companies made their own commercials for theater release. But more importantly, the stars on screen were highly influential smoking role models. With the movies, the tobacco industry left nothing to chance. Big stars like Clark Gable were sent packages of free cigarettes in an effort to put the industry's product on screen.
The real problem, because they all smoked in those days, was getting them to show the Lucky Strike package where the bullseye was in the picture so that you would know that they were smoking Luckies. I was always astonished that the giants like Clark would be so nice about getting a free carton a week. And to my astonishment, no matter how much money they were making, a free carton a week really, really made a big hit with them.
Goodbye, folks. Good smoking. And hope for Philip Morris.
By the end of the 1930s, two American surgeons had become increasingly concerned by the increase in the number of their patients with lung cancer.
It had become more frequent than cancer of the stomach, which was considered one of the common cancers at that time. And so that was very impressive. Here it is, from 1912 to 1939, you see, a period of just a couple of decades, a disease has now become from the rarest of diseases to one of the most common. And that's what impressed us tremendously.
Michael DeBakey, today an internationally renowned heart surgeon, soon became convinced of a connection between the lung cancers and cigarettes.
We were very impressed by the fact that virtually all the patients were long-term heavy smokers, with the exception of two women in the entire series.
DeBakey's partner at the time wrote to the Surgeon General and unsuccessfully tried to engage his medical colleagues in the subject.
It was frustrating not to be, in a sense, taken very seriously. We were serious, but in general there was great skepticism about our belief. And that was frustrating because we thought we had pretty good evidence. The idea that this was an unhealthy habit was simply not acceptable. Everybody was smoking.
During World War II, the cigarette habit exploded. A world war meant a world market for the product. In a major deal with the United States, Britain spent more on tobacco than on tanks or ships or planes.
Cigarettes were very important for troops during the war. It wasn't possible, really, for a warship, to leave port without an adequate supply of smoking tobacco, cigarettes. And every soldier had to have cigarettes in his rations. Were absolutely essential for the morale of the troops.
The Overseas League organized a tobacco fund quite early in the war to provide smokes for the services. And the first donor was His Majesty the King. Smokes are in camp and the boys feel as delighted as you do.
Even as Britain prepared for a German invasion, cigarettes weren't far from the planners' minds. Here, deep beneath Whitehall in the cabinet war rooms, Winston Churchill and his senior advisors ran the war. Britain's planners regarded maintaining the supply of cigarettes a top priority. They considered tobacco a necessity, not only for the troops, but also for civilians back home. Such a necessity, in fact, that a secret plan provided for every citizen to be supplied with 45 cigarettes a week in the event of invasion. Cigarettes were not rationed in Britain during the war, but there were shortages. They became a currency in their own right, a lucrative business for those prepared to exploit it.
cigarettes were like gold dust. And you went out thieving to get hundreds of thousands of them. And the buyers who bought the cigarettes off you literally bit your hand off to buy them off you. It was, fantastic.
Frankie Frazier served 3.5 years in prison for stealing cigarettes. As a teenager during the war, he understood their value.
Everybody wanted to smoke then, with the bombing and doodle bubs and V2s and one thing or another. There were loved ones in the army abroad, the wives and that working. Everybody wanted to smoke. I'll never forgive Hitler for surrendering during the war. It were wonderful days. They were my best pal, my best friend. Thank God for cigarettes.
The Second World War internationalized American cigarette brands like Lucky Strike. Everywhere American troops went, so did their cigarettes. They even found their way into Hitler's Germany.
We can well imagine how German audiences would have cheered this story had it reached their cinemas, and how they would have gloated over their men at the front enjoying a really decent smoke at last from captured American cigarettes and cigars.
By the end of the war, 82% of British men smoked.
Everything possible was done for them, cigarettes and a snack for each man on his way home.
The returning troops didn't realize they were coming home to a newly emerging epidemic disease, lung cancer. In post-war Britain, public health officials studied autopsy results and found evidence of an epidemic. Lung cancer in men had increased 5,000% in less than 40 years, surpassing prostate and stomach cancer. No one knew what was causing it. The officials told Richard Dahl, a young medical statistician and cigarette smoker, to find the cause of the epidemic. Experts considered air pollution the likeliest explanation, especially given the increasing reliance on automobiles.
Motor traffic was an obvious possible explanation, and the tarring of roads, because they had become much more common. And indeed, that was what I would have put my money on if I'd had to bet at the time before we started the study.
But it wasn't long before Richard Dahl, through his survey of 5,000 patients in British hospitals, identified a relationship between smoking cigarettes and lung cancer.
The association was strong enough to make me give up smoking in the course of the study. You see, we found that people who were smoking over 25 cigarettes a day, they had 30 times the risk of developing lung cancer as a non-smoker. Our final conclusion was definitely that smoking cigarettes was a cause, and an important cause, of cancer of the lung.
It was a great shock. We had never thought of tobacco as being a danger to health. In fact, we thought tobacco was a beneficial product. And this obviously was a great shock to us, and we were at first totally disbelieving of it.
I read this report. I read it cynically, because I'd had several comments to me, "Have you read this nonsense, old boy, that these doctor chappies are coming out with?" And so I read it in that frame of mind, and instead of which I began to think, what are we doing? We're killing people. Should this be happening? And I expected to find everyone as concerned as I was and worried as I was. And instead of which, I found just the opposite. Instead of saying, is this true? If so, what are we to do? Should we start research to counter it? Should we try to get a new form of cigarette? Instead of that reaction, the reaction was, how can we rubbish this?
Imperial Tobacco, makers of Player cigarettes and the largest manufacturer in Britain, set out to undermine Dahl's findings.
The Imperial Tobacco Company took a rather different view from us. They took the view that the Dahl report was not true and they would have do nothing about it. We were a little less skeptical than that.
The company policy was that
we as tobacco manufacturers were not qualified to make any medical judgments. Now, that was the company's stance on that, and I believe it was absolutely right that and has stood the test of time. So that has always been my line. I'm not a doctor, I'm not qualified, and I wouldn't presume to make any judgments.
As the doctors and nurses relax in the open space that surrounds their hospital of tents, a dusty paddy field in summer and a swampy marsh in winter, they take a welcome breather before the next emergency case arrives.
In fact, by the middle of the century, most doctors smoked heavily. Some physicians even emphasized the medicinal benefits of cigarettes as a reliever of stress. In its advertisements, the tobacco industry used doctors and their fondness for smoking to reassure the public. The emphasis was on relieving throat irritation, not curing disease. Indeed, the medical profession also was employed to cast doubt on the link between cancer and smoking.
Last thing we wanted was people to question smoking. We had, for instance, one doctor who was Harley Street, very good address, and we knew that he could be relied on to write to the Times whenever there was anything new, saying, this is not true, it's sheer imagination, it's scaremongering. And it was thoroughly, thoroughly cynical.
Americans enjoying the fruits of a strong post-war economy were oblivious to such health fears. Some, like 17-year-old Janet Sackman, even found work promoting a product that would eventually take its toll.
When I was a teenager, a gentleman stopped me on a beach and told me to go down to see the modeling agency. He thought I'd be a good all-American girl type.
Janet became the lucky strike girl. They suggested she start smoking to look more convincing when handling the product.
There was a gentleman there from the tobacco companies. Then he asked me if I smoked. Then I said, no, I don't. Then he said, you're an up-and-coming bottle. It would be a good idea if you learned how to hold a cigarette. And after that, I started to smoke.
Janet soon had a 35-cigarette-a-day habit.
Everyone smoked, so we didn't know what it could do to you.
All that was about to change. New York, December 15th, 1953. In the United States, crisis was in the air. Tobacco's top executives descended on Manhattan, headed for a highly secret meeting at the Plaza Hotel. They were trying to stave off disaster. Cigarette sales were falling dramatically, and the repercussions were ringing throughout the industry. The news was out, cigarettes cause cancer.
At that point, the scientific challenge had reached a large and very threatening dimension, and the industry decided that since it was being publicized at great length and with great volume, that the industry should respond in a public way.
That response was to deny the health charges. They placed a so-called frank statement to the public from the tobacco industry in papers across America. Thus began the longest and costliest public relations campaign in history.
We accept an interest in people's health as a basic responsibility paramount to every other consideration in our business.
They launched a campaign to fund apparently independent scientific research into cigarettes, but those who worked for them are clear as to the real purpose behind it.
There were pacts made between the devil and the unimaginable. Its intent was to create disinformation. They sat down in the 1950s and sketched out a long-term plan that would delay regulation, delay and offset litigation for as long as possible.
The tobacco industry's main response to public health fears was to promote filtered cigarettes.
The objective of our research was to find how smokers could be protected against nicotine and tars, which are present in all cigarettes.
And so Rothmans introduced Britain's first cigarette with the built-in filter. The cigarette with the protection so many smokers are seeking today.
Then the filter came through, which of course was the great breakthrough in smoking, which made it all right. If you'd ever heard anything about anti-smoking, filters made it good.
The problem was filters couldn't be proven to be more healthy, despite the claims. Privately, industry scientists referred to them as health image cigarettes.
The first thing that you have to understand is a filter is not a health device. A filter is a marketing device.
And when you think your way through all the filter claims, you come to the cigarette with a thinking man's filter, smoking man's taste. Viceroy. Thinking man's filter, smoking man's taste.
Smoking machines were eventually introduced to test tar levels in filtered cigarettes, but the machines were an unreliable guide to safer smoking. What the companies, but not the public, realized was that smokers could neutralize any benefits the filter provided.
The supposition was if you lower tar, it's better. But you remember that when we talk about lowering tar, that's in governmental tests. That's not the way people smoke cigarettes. People can take a low-tar cigarette and by drawing on it harder or holding it in longer, they can get the same amount of tar and nicotine as they can with a high-tar cigarette.
When they did this, they changed the inhalation pattern and with it changed the nature of the kind of diseases that occurred.
At Philip Morris, we had videos of people doing this. I mean, you can watch a person smoke a cigarette in a minute, the whole thing. I mean, just give themselves a real good dose.
We also really increased the prevalence of emphysema. That's gone up over the past 20 years, and in part of it may be due to this lowering of tar and nicotine. Inhaling more deeply, getting the smoke out to the part of the lung where emphysema occurs.
Later on, companies realized they could design filters to cheat these machines deliberately. One cigarette marketing executive advised his client on how to do it.
The thing that I told him was you should try and deceive the public, and that with your filters, you put vents in them. Now, if you put the vents lengthwise, like this, going down the filter, the cigarette machines, when they test the brands, won't close up the vents because they're very careful about that. But people smoking it will close up the vents like this with their lips when they smoke. So they were smoking something five times as strong as what they thought they were, or 500% more. Really. It was naughty.
We ambushed the consumer. We ambushed him.
Big tobacco's strategy was working. In the industry's own words, suspicion was still widespread, but the lynching party was off. The crisis was over, and people were smoking again.
You're smoking a cigarette, the world is at peace.
Smoke, smoke, smoke that cigarette.
St. Peter at the Golden Gate, that you hate to make him wait, but you just gotta have another cigarette.
Everybody seemed to take smoking as a sort of natural pleasure. And the industry, as a result, prospered. And rightly so.
Good morning, Mr. Hill. Today's duty check, 1,061,000.
Imperial Tobacco accountants go through the daily ritual of making out a check to the government for excise duty on cigarettes. By the mid-1950s, this tobacco revenue was paying for much of Britain's welfare state.
The tobacco industry was a very important and very cheap way of raising government revenue. We used to sign a check for over £1 million a day. You know, as the tobacco came in, you couldn't actually clear it until the check had gone to the customs. So we were an enormous source of revenue. They were very pragmatic, the Treasury. They didn't have any hang-ups about the desirability of the tobacco industry being strong and profitable.
Coffin nails. Yes, that's what cigarettes are, according to the Medical Research Council. A press conference by the Ministry of Health had the ear of the whole country. Ashtrays liberally provided.
In 1957, the British government formally accepted the link between heavy smoking and lung cancer. Publicly, the tobacco industry continued to reject any connection between smoking and health.
There is need for much more research over a wide area, and in my opinion, to single out smoking as a causal agent is, on the evidence to date, completely unjustified.
Well, thank you very much, sir, for your help.
Well, thank you very much for letting me put our views forward. You better have a cigarette before you go.
Thank you.
Privately, it was a different story. The industry had produced cancer in mice well before the end of the 1950s. Companies started to give code names to incriminating words like cancer, which one company dubbed Zephyr. But such research remained secret.
Tobacco industry reports on their research are magnificent works of fiction. They should appear in the Booker Prize. When we put money in for research, we put it research in straitjackets so that the people were limited to how far they looked. And if they came beyond a certain point, which would reflect badly on the tobacco industry, it came to an end.
Never, 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 never go.
The real money was going not into research, but into promotion. The cigarette is one of the most heavily promoted products of all time.
If you did not advertise, then your brand died.
The time, the pace, the cigarette, weights tipped.
It was vital to the success of any brand.
The most important thing about it was status. It gave you place in society in some strange way.
The cigarette has to have an image. When that man goes to a counter and asks a pack of cigarettes, he's already got a name in mind.
You're never alone with a strand.
Cigarettes were indeed a great friend.
Are you a real smoker? Always have cigarettes with you.
You've got to get into the mind of the smoker that he feels, this is my brand. I like it. I feel part of it.
Take a tip, take a Bristol. Today's cigarette is a Bristol.
The adverts were really sort of like a sticker to say, yes, this is okay to do, you know. They were making it acceptable.
Bristol is today's cigarette.
People are terribly brand loyal to their cigarettes. They almost never change.
Marlboro Country is
the aim of advertising is not only to sell cigarettes, it's to lull people's fears. Deceptive? Of course they're deceptive. What are they going to do? Go out and say, buy our product, it'll kill you. Chief model for Marlboro died from lung cancer, as you know, and the trade they call Marlboro's cowboy killers.
Oh, there must be millions of good people like us who go for king-size filter cigarette that you can really taste.
You also want to have a high degree of sexuality in the appeal because cigarettes are essentially very close to a sexual product.
May I have one of those senior service king-size filter cigarettes I've heard so much about?
Well, when they were shooting a smoking commercial, they had all the money in the world and they sure used it. It was all up there on the screen. I was offered Benson Hedges cigarette commercial in Amsterdam. It was a great job, paid a lot of money. And you got free cigarettes for about 3 months, I think. You know, so packets and packets of cigarettes. You got cartons of them. You were led into believing that this was the height of sophistication and that you were in no danger. The clever thing about it was it looked so marvellous. And there is also some wonderful, wonderful thing about gold, isn't there? I mean, it's like having a gold block in your hand.
It is the thing that we almost desire, gold. So we have on the one hand all the aspirations of Mayfair, St. James's, and quality, and the, or dare I say, representation of class structure in this country, plus coating that most avaricious ornament to gold. You put your pack on the bar, and people thought, hey, he belongs to that group of people, or dare I say it, he is one of those people, or he aspires to be one of those people.
Even though on both sides of the Atlantic, the public seemed reassured by the industry's campaigns, politicians seemingly would have had to act eventually on the mounting evidence against cigarettes. But the industry's power base was deeply embedded within the body politic. The American tobacco leaf is built into the very design of the U.S. Capitol. Tobacco always has been an integral part of American politics. Here in Washington, at the center of the federal government, the cigarette companies have wielded enormous political power. Throughout the century, they've fought any significant regulation, pouring huge resources into lobbying Congress and the White House. In 1962, President John F. Kennedy established a committee of scientists to examine the available evidence about smoking and health. It was the first official challenge to big tobacco.
This was the full power of the government and the scientific community being marshaled against a legal product. It was a threat, it was perceived to be a threat by the industry, and many in the industry felt that perhaps the end was nigh.
In Louisville, top industry lawyers were increasingly anxious about the outcome of the scientists' deliberations. They had their own secret research showing the addictive nature of nicotine. One of their top executives wrote confidentially, "We are in the business of selling nicotine, an addictive drug." He argued for the disclosure of such research, but his company and its parent, British American Tobacco, decided, like others in the industry, to withhold evidence from the committee.
We expected the tobacco companies to share freely, since they had had an equal place at the table in selecting the committee. Their collaboration and cooperation was pledged, but it never occurred.
The committee's fiercest debate was over whether nicotine was addictive or merely habit-forming, raising the question of how freely the smoker smoked. Many on the committee felt it was clearly more than a habit.
I felt that this was so clearly addicting, regardless of what the definition was, that it was really quite unfair to the issue to call it just a habit. The year after we finished this report, the World Health Organization changed the definition of addiction so that nicotine fitted beautifully under it, and today it is now the most addicting substance in the world.
The industry had secret ties to two committee members. One of these men wrote the chapter on addiction. The industry got its way. They were not so pleased, however, with the committee's main conclusion.
In view of the continuing and mounting evidence from many sources, it is a judgment of the committee that cigarette smoking contributes substantially to mortality from certain specific diseases and to the overall death rate.
It was now official, though the industry still denied it. Cigarettes were killers. But smokers at the time, like Janet Sackman, the former Lucky Strike girl, just kept on smoking.
Side by side, but we'll travel along.
Janet developed throat cancer. She's now teaching other throat cancer victims to speak without a voice box. Janet also has lung cancer.
When I started, I had no idea that it was dangerous. They started talking about the Surgeon General's report, and even then, I didn't listen. I didn't want to hear that. I was addicted. I couldn't stop.
The industry reacted to the Surgeon General's report by denying the health charges and forming a secret committee dominated by lawyers. Chief among them was David Hardy, who wanted protection for the industry. He saw his opportunity in the growing demands for health warning labels on cigarettes.
For a long time, there was no warning label on packages of cigarettes, and it looked like the industry was fighting that. Actually, they weren't. They wanted a label on there, and once the label was on there, they wanted to buy time. David Hardy, who was the chief architect of their litigation defense, wanted the label, but he needed time for the label to be on there, 10, 15, 20 years. And in so doing, they could transfer the accountability, the responsibility for any adverse health effects from the industry to the consumer.
It made it very difficult for any plaintiff's lawyers to claim that a smoker was inadequately warned or didn't know the risks of smoking, because as a matter of law, the Congress had found that they were adequately warned.
The industry's secret strategy for survival would prove a winning formula. All attempts at litigation against them failed throughout this period, and most cigarette smokers just kept on smoking.
This is an American epidemic that has now spread worldwide, and the mechanism of spread has been by the tobacco companies.
It's an industry that somewhere stepped over a line that we trust industries not to step over, and they never went back.
If there is any answer to be found, the tobacco industry wants to find it. It wants to close the gaps in information on the smoking and health controversy.
With no coherent opposition challenging it yet, the cigarette industry was undoubtedly winning the tobacco wars, hands down.
Has anybody got a match?
Now, medical science offers you proof.
Remember, eminent doctors.
In cases of irritation due to smoking.
Top-ranking nose and throat specialists actually suggest.
Smoke Raleigh's and tune in on Tuesday.
And always easy on your throat.
Now I can light an old gold and listen to Frank Sinatra.
Why not smoke cools over the weekend? Give your throat a little relaxation.
No other cigarette is safer to smoke.